Welcome again to Coastal Matters. I'm Charlie Walters. This is a co-production of Nantucket Community Television, Channel 18, and the Nantucket Coastal Conservancy. My guest today is Kaitlyn Shaw, who is the Water Resource Specialist for the Town of Nantucket's Natural Resource Department. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
I want to start wide and then narrow it down a bit. As of today, August 17th, what is the state of the water quality of Nantucket's harbor, for starters?
So in terms of water quality for the harbor, we look at a couple of different things. We do look at the nutrients in the water, which give us an idea of how much algae can grow. And in terms of nutrients, we aren't meeting our goals in the head of the harbor or in Pulpis Harbor.
No, the head of the harbor is up by Walwinnet, yep. For those who don't know.
Yes. Those are where our sentinel stations are, which are the stations that we set our goals to achieve, such that if we achieve our nutrient goals in that area, then the rest of the harbor will also be improving as well.
When you say a sentinel station, I mean, if somebody goes out to the head of the harbor, are they going to recognize something as being a measuring device?
No. There will be oxygen meters deployed in the head of the harbor and Pulpis Harbor because they are the sentinel stations, but it's based on a latitude and longitude that we have in the boat, and we go to that station. So there's no physical station that anybody would be able to see.
It's just a spot you go to from time to time to do measuring.
Yeah, we sample the Nantucket Harbor every 2 weeks from June to September.
Now, Nantucket Harbor extends from town up to the head of the harbor. And does that include Pulpis Harbor for the context of what we're talking about?
It does, although Pulpis Harbor is a sub-embayment, and because it does have that constriction, it would historically support different water quality. So we have a different goal in terms of nutrients for that subsection.
Explain the term you just used to differentiate Pulpis Harbor.
Which term?
A sub-embayment? Yes.
Okay, so there would be a watershed where the water from that area drains into Pulpis Harbor, but since there's a connection to Nantucket Harbor, the water that goes into Pulpis Harbor is then going into Nantucket Harbor. So the Nantucket Harbor is the main embayment, and Pulpis Harbor is the sub-embayment or a water body that's connected to the main harbor.
Well, let's stop there for a second. Where does the Pulpis Harbor water that you're talking about come from?
It comes from the land. So anything that we do on land occurs within a watershed. And what a watershed is it's based on the topography of the land surrounding a water body. So if you are doing something on your property and you might not be right adjacent to the water, but you exist within the watershed such that the water that goes onto the land does make its way to the surface water bodies. And that could be the ocean, or it could be Pulpis Harbor, or a pond, or Nantucket Harbor. So that's why we're really concerned about what goes on land and controlling some of our inputs from the land.
And for those not very familiar with the island, there are no rivers on Nantucket. There are little creeks, narrow creeks here and there, but there's no river system that can be called that.
Yeah, there are a couple of streams, and also groundwater seepage is one way that you can get water from the watershed. The water will travel through the ground and then make its way to the surface water, either through a little stream or directly along the coast of the harbor or pond.
Now, you mentioned nutrients a minute ago. Mm-hmm. What are those nutrients?
Sure. So we'll kind of go back a little bit to explain. The big word for what I study is called eutrophication, and it explains what the process by which our water bodies can get kind of sickened is. Nutrients in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus, they drive plant growth, and they exist in all plant and animal matter and waste. So these nutrients are basically crucial for plant growth. But when there's too many nutrients, we have an overgrowth of plants. And that overgrowth can cause a cascade of negative effects, which is the term eutrophication. So eutrophication is an over-enrichment of nutrients in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus, causing an overabundance of algae, which then can create low visibility in the water, and certain plant species like eelgrass like really clear water. So this progression of increased nutrients and increased algae can lead to shifts in the plant species dominance.
Now, on the surface, not literally, but you would think that having more plant life would be a good thing. It's not. Explain why that is.
Sure. It's a really good point. We want there to be a diverse assemblage, so many different types of plants present. We don't mind seeing macroalgae or seaweed, but we don't want to see seaweed in such a quantity that it is choking out the eelgrass. And I spent a long time studying seaweed in grad school, but basically when you have high nutrients, you get a shift where there's a lot of algae in the water, and opportunistic seaweeds really like low light conditions and high nutrient conditions. So the seaweed does really, really well, and it outcompetes the eelgrass. And that's something that worldwide is going on right now, and we're trying to educate people as to why some of our inputs need to be reduced in order to protect those diverse assemblage of plants in the system, because they can be really beneficial for the animals that live in the system, like scallops and fish.
Yeah, talk some more about that, about the eelgrass and scallops and how they interact.
Mm-hmm. So eelgrass, it does many different things in terms of the ecosystem benefits. In terms of scallops, when scallops are very tiny, they are predated by crabs and other animals in the harbor. And what happens is that the very, very tiny scallops will use the eelgrass as a way to hide and attach to the blades of grass, so that they can get off of the bottom and get away from those predators. So having eelgrass or something similar to eelgrass that allows them to get away from their predators helps them survive the crucial time when they're very young and susceptible to getting eaten by other creatures.
Green crabs, talk about those, because they got some publicity lately.
Yeah. What basically is going on right now is that green crabs are an invasive species, and they, the things that they eat, including shellfish, are actually in the eelgrass. The eelgrass is the habitat where much of what they eat lives in. So what happens is they can actually dig up the roots of the eelgrass and create some problems for scallops and actually for the eelgrass itself. So there's some research going on with the Mariah Mitchell Association and the Nantucket Land Council, along with our department, to look into green crabs and see if we can kind of understand it's a pilot project to understand what their numbers are, and also to try to see if they can develop a market for them. So if we can develop a market for those green crabs, then we would be doing something good for the harbor, but also creating kind of a little bit of an economic situation around them. So this is something that the Emily at the Nantucket Land Council Emily Molden is working on, yep.
How big is a green crab, and where have they come from?
I'm not particularly sure. I mean, I know that they're invasive, and I'm not sure exactly where they came from, but they're about this big.
So it's about 6 inches, we'll say. Yeah. Not including the claws.
Yeah, maybe a little bit smaller like this. Mm-hmm. But yeah, our department is helping with the use of the boats for that project, but I'm not personally involved in the project just because I have other projects going on with water quality specifically.
Now, this surplus of nutrients,
mm-hmm.
why is there a surplus of nutrients?
Sure. So it goes back to the early 1900s, actually, to give a little bit of a historic perspective on nutrients. In the past, nutrients, there's forms of nutrients that are available for use by plants, and then there's forms that are unavailable. Historically, and before, you know, the Industrial Revolution, we would get the usable form of nutrients from either soil microbes or basically bacteria transferring that unusable form of nitrogen into a usable form, or you could get it from the atmosphere or from lightning would also produce that. So those are the natural ways that that available nitrogen could be produced. In the early 1900s, there was a development which basically made synthetic fertilizers. So they developed a process by which they could take nitrogen from the atmosphere and turn it directly into the usable form. So that was kind of putting a little cog in the in nature's cycle. So this basically made it so that nitrogen could be more available in the usable form, and this had a direct correlation to the population increase around that time. So as this development came about, then the population increased, and as we know, our waste contains nutrients, so more population and more production of nutrients. In the same sense, during this time frame, you can look at historically the occurrences of hypoxia, which is low oxygen. And over this time frame of increased population growth, we've seen also an increase in the occurrence of low oxygen events. So basically, from wastewater, the direct use of fertilizers, and it doesn't matter whether they're organic or synthetic, a fertilizer in and of itself is those nutrients that plants require to grow. So
a fertilizer is a fertilizer.
A fertilizer is a fertilizer. I mean, you might be more concerned about the chemicals that are contained in some non-organic forms, but I think a lot of people feel like if they're using organic fertilizer that it is less impactful in terms of eutrophication, and I don't think that that's the case because it's still a nutrient that drives plant growth. And then we also have inputs from the atmosphere. So the burning of fossil fuels actually increases the available nutrients coming from wet and dry deposition from the atmosphere. So we kind of have nutrients coming in from all sides, actually, but we're trying to educate the public on using less fertilizer, having their landscapers licensed to apply it so that they're using the proper amount, and also making sure that people have their septic systems are working properly so that we can kind of get a handle on how much of those nutrients are getting into our water bodies.
Well, this links up to the discussion the town has been having for a long time about sewering Nantucket instead of just having septic tanks. And I'm assuming you think sewering, aside from being conforming with the law, is a better idea than having septic tanks all over the western end of the island.
When it comes to sewering versus septic, our wastewater treatment facility is very advanced compared to what a normal Title V septic system can do. And obviously, Roberto at the health department can elucidate more on this. But from the solely scientific standpoint, our wastewater treatment facility can really treat that water very highly, whereas a septic system just can't. And innovative alternative septic systems can remove more nitrogen because they have a little piece of that biological process within them. But I still think that the sewers take out the most and protect our water quality the best. So just from a scientific standpoint, I know there's other issues involved.
Yes. This past winter, they redid the two jetties, the west and the east jetty. And I'm told that has increased the rate of speed of tides by a knot. In terms, or in the context of what we're talking about, is that a big difference? Does that get more junk out of the harbor more efficiently?
Yes. So there's a couple of things at play in terms of improving water quality. You can reduce your inputs or you can increase flushing, which increasing the height of the jetty was modeled to increase flushing by 3/4 of a knot. And our department didn't have any specific studies that looked at the speed of flow after, but you can just tell from being in the harbor and going out through the jetty on a regular basis that there has been an increase in flushing for sure since that project has been done. And the previous scientific studies with the Massachusetts Estuaries reports modeled that increasing the height of the jetty, following the best management practices for fertilizer, and extending the sewer system up as we did 2 years ago to the Shimo area would get us to our goal. But we need to take into consideration that is looking at a predicted amount of development. So if that amount of development changes, then that we just always need to keep that in mind.
Before we move on from the harbor, I just want to be clear for people. If you're not using fertilizers properly, you can get a ticket or something like that. We are talking about town rules and regulations here.
Yeah. When a landscaper is not abiding by the best management practices for fertilizer application, someone from my department or someone from the health department can actually give them a ticket, a citation for not abiding by that regulation.
Before we go on to Great Ponds, tell us a bit about yourself. Where did you grow up? Where did you study?
Sure. So I grew up in New York in a town called Cross River. It's about an hour north of Manhattan. I grew up going to visit my grandparents here on Nantucket and in Florida. And ever since I was a little kid, was interested in the marine environment. I was always doing little experiments and investigating the coastal areas of either here or Florida, where my grandparents had a house. I went to the University of Connecticut, Avery Point, which is the marine science campus of UConn, and I graduated with 8 people for undergrad with a degree in coastal studies, although we had them change it to coastal science or marine science now after we left.
Just 8 people.
Yeah, it was an extremely small college, and it was very specific. I worked in a lab looking at dissolved oxygen concentrations in Long Island Sound. I got a lot of experience there, which was very lucky for an undergraduate to get that kind of experience. From there, I went to an internship at Save the Bay in Narragansett Bay, Rhode Island, and I did eelgrass restoration work and some scallop restoration work as well. And then from there, I went to UMass Dartmouth School for Marine Science and Technology and got a master's in coastal system science. And I studied nutrient enrichment and seaweed growth. So that's my history. And it's pretty incredible that I grew up coming to Nantucket and now I work in the building that I used to go to learn about scallops and eelgrass when I was a kid. So
I was going to say, it's fortunate that you're in a place you know in a field that lends itself to what your background is.
Yeah.
The Great Ponds. Nantucket has dozens and dozens and dozens of ponds of all sizes, but there are 4 great ponds, and you work in those. Mm-hmm. Which are the great ponds, first of all?
Sure. So the great ponds are Sacagawea, Myokomet, Hummock Pond, and Long Pond. For a little bit of background, 2 of those ponds, Sacagawea Pond and Hummock Pond, get opened twice per year to the ocean, physically opened with an excavator, to enhance the anadromous fish resources.
So those, what does that mean?
Those are the fish that come from the ocean and go into a more freshwater system to spawn and have their young. And then we open the pond so that those young can come out of the system later on. And that also has a that can increase flushing, so that can increase the health, the water quality of the pond, but we don't rely necessarily on opening the ponds just for the health of them. The permit is based on our letting fish enter the pond and exit the pond.
So are those ponds brackish, salt, fresh?
Yep. So we only have...
So they're brackish.
They are brackish. They vary in degrees of salinity based on how successful the openings are. And sometimes the openings can be a little bit tricky, to say the least, because there's a lot of moving parts in terms of our ability to access the beach to open it because of protected species. Also, we want to have a certain wind and tide conditions at the same time. And we strive for over 3-day openings. Longer openings mean more exchange with the ocean. So it can be tricky to get all of those pieces to line up. And it's something that we're kind of looking into in terms of the successfulness. So we've had a couple of studies looking at how successful the openings are in terms of improving water quality. And we've talked to the Department of Marine Fisheries about maybe getting some video cameras to look at actually what fish are using these openings to come and spawn, to really get the data behind the action of opening the ponds, because it has historically been done, but we really want to know how successful it is.
If you didn't do it, what would those ponds look like over time? And sure. What time frame?
So they'll become fresh quite quickly because depending on how big their watershed is, for instance, my Comet Pond used to be opened to the ocean and historically, and they, because of flooding issues a number of years ago, they tried to install a system where they could let water out of the pond. The ponds will fill in with fresh water very, very quickly based on the watershed that's draining into them. And once they become fresh water, over time, there'll be a change in the main nutrient of concern. Although nitrogen and phosphorus are both important for plant growth in saltwater systems, nitrogen is more limiting, meaning that if there's no nitrogen, then the plants can't grow. Whereas in freshwater systems, that nutrient of concern is phosphorus. So over time, we'll be kind of shifting if we stopped opening the ponds from a dominated kind of management of nitrogen because of the saltwater influence to more of a management of phosphorus.
Now, are the fish affected the same way that scallops are affected by having too many nutrients in the water?
Yes.
The fish and the turtles in some cases.
Yeah, it's an indirect, they are affected, and the way by which they're affected has to do with dissolved oxygen. When there's a bloom of plant matter, algae, and other aquatic vegetation, pond weeds and such, that mass of plant matter eventually is going to die. And when it does, it will sink to the bottom and consume oxygen, meaning that bacteria will process that decaying matter and consume oxygen in the process, meaning that the dissolved oxygen in the water will get to very critically low levels. And when that happens in certain circumstances, the fish can't find a spot that has enough oxygen and they can die. So that's how fish and shellfish are affected by degraded water quality, is that the oxygen conditions will be affected.
If I remember correctly, in 2016, there was a private organization that sent a machine out to get muck or whatever out of some of the ponds.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
And yep.
Can you explain that better than I just did?
Yep, the harvester is actually here now. So,
really?
Yeah. I just was in Hummock Pond before I came here. And so what that is that the Pond Coalition...
Nantucket Pond Coalition,
which is
not a governmental agency. That's private.
Yeah, it's a private citizen organization. they have the harvester come basically to remove that thick vegetation that makes it difficult to boat in the systems. And so they'll come and this harvester basically rips up, cuts the vegetation, and then they bring it to the shore. And I think that some local farmers will use it as a fertilizer, which is interesting because when we're using a fertilizer that comes in a bag, we're adding additional fertilizer to our little ecosystem of Nantucket. But if you use something that already is existing in plant form, then you're not needing to add that additional outside nitrogen. Mm-hmm. So it's nice to use something like that to have that be recycled.
Instead of just taking it to the dump.
Yeah. Because ultimately, you need to think about it in the sense that all plant matter, all decaying matter is providing nutrients. So the way that we dispose of that is important. And it you really can think about your pile of, leaves that you leave out, on your property and how that might, on a larger scale, affect a system, an ecosystem.
Now, we're on Brant Point as we're taping this, and your office is really just down the street. Where is your office?
Our office is located at Brant Point in the Shellfish Hatchery. There's offices upstairs, and that's where we operate out of, which is really fantastic because when I want to take my phytoplankton sample for the week, all I have to do is walk downstairs onto the dock and take my sample, and then I can go up to the microscope and process it. So it's really a fantastic spot to do work.
Is the public allowed to stop by?
Yes. So I don't typically give tours, but my colleagues Tara and Leah do give tours when they're able to. I would suggest if anybody wanted to have a tour to contact them, just to make sure that they're not in the middle of a scallop spawning event or something that is time sensitive. But yes, it is quite an interesting facility. We have the purple lights that are emanating from our facility are actually
disco, it's science.
Yeah, they're actually how we grow algae to feed to the baby scallops and oysters.
And this is the last big building before you get to the lighthouse. It's almost all the way to the end of Brant Point.
Yep.
Past the Coast Guard.
Mm-hmm.
Kaitlyn Shaw, thanks very much for coming in. This has been fascinating.
Thank you.
For Coastal Matters, I'm Charlie Walters. Thanks for tuning in. Please tune in again.